In this lesson, we begin our journey through the math and physics needed to learn quantum algorithms. Let's take a peek at a few of the pages you'll be reading today. But remember, depending on your mathematical background, I've outlined different paths through the book, so you probably will only need to read a subset of what's in the chapter. Last time, we learned that quantum computing is based on something called a qubit. And although it's too early for me to give you a formal definition, at least I can show you the scribbles that we'll use to write out a qubit when the time comes. This mysterious set of symbols contains two Greek letters, alpha and beta. These guys are complex variables, that is, each represents a complex value which may or may not be known to us at any given moment. Today, we learn, or for some of you, review what complex numbers are and how they differ from the more familiar real numbers, or as I like to call them, the reals. And in case you forgot your terminology, real numbers are the ones you use every day, numbers like 1.01, 9, minus 6, and even the famous irrational but still real number, pi. We build up the complex number system by starting with a new literal constant called I. I is the square root of negative 1, already a creature that doesn't exist in the reals. From there, we construct all possible combinations of I with other real numbers. Here are a few examples. Just as we can consider a real number to be a point on the real number line from minus infinity to infinity, we can also view a complex number visually, but here we're going to need two dimensions. Each complex number will now be some point in the complex plane. Of course, we'll have to define what we mean by adding, subtracting, multiplying, and dividing complex numbers, and you'll have a chance to do some optional exercises. We'll learn about polar representations, a different way to write out complex numbers that has advantages in some situations. You'll learn some vocabulary, terms like complex conjugate, modulus, argument, and some fun properties of these new objects. One of the most important identities you'll encounter in today's reading is Euler's formula, which expresses the exponential function e to the x in terms of the trigonometric functions sine and cosine. Now, I'll develop Euler's formula using some relatively simple algebra, but you don't need to memorize or even understand that derivation. I just want you to be able to recognize the formula when you see it and associate it with the name Euler. When I learned about complex numbers years ago, without a doubt, my favorite takeaway from the first week of class was how easy it was to derive the addition laws for sine and cosine without any of the messy trigonometry. Part of the reason that made such an impression was that I was terrible at trig and I hated it. I include that short derivation with several other optional topics just in case you're interested. You'll see that I labeled those sections optional or even skippable in your recommended reading tables further down this web page. A relevant section for us as quantum computer scientists will come at the very end. It's called Roots of Unity. You won't need to read it all, but I've tagged one small subsection as required, just so you know what we're talking about later in the course when we mention the so-called nth roots of unity. If you have the time and are not intimidated, go ahead and try out the sections and exercises on summing roots of unity, since I'll be citing some of those results when we get to Shor's factoring algorithm at the end of the course. With that, I'll let you have some fun working your way through the chapter. Try out a few exercises, scribble down a computation or two, and if you have any questions, please feel free to post them to our class forums or drop into the STEM Center on the Foothill College campus.